Hi, how's it going, everyone? Welcome to the 7th episode of the Talks with Experts video series. My name is Eva, and today we are talking about game analytics with the manager of the department, Peter. Welcome.
Hi, thank you for having me.
You are welcome. But before we dive into the video, please be sure to join Facebook group called Free-to-Play Game Developers, where you can discuss this topic further. The link is below the video. So there's no doubt that game analytics is super important for our company. So Petya, tell me, what exactly are the responsibilities of a game analyst here in Pixel Federation?
Well, basically it's everything that revolves around data. So we have a designated analyst on every of our projects, and even two on Diggy's Adventure. And basically, as you know, you can have qualitative and quantitative feedback for your games. You work as a community manager, so you know you are the voice of the people. So this is something like qualitative feedback, but this can be biased because you know usually the least satisfied players are the most vocal.
Yeah.
So that's where we come into the equation, and we can look at the data and provide some objective view of the changes and like the actual response of the players, how do they interact with features and stuff like this. We provide our game designers with qualitative feedback, so they actually know what are the effects of the changes that they make in the games. Mm-hmm. Apart from game analysts, we have also two analysts working directly on our marketing department, working closely not with game designers, but with our marketing team, helping them to optimize our user acquisition channels. And we also have our own data engineering team that are responsible for the infrastructure, the data warehousing, and some tools, and basically looking for ways to improve the effectivity of the whole analytics department.
Interesting. Can you name and describe for us some of the tools you use?
Sure. First of all, it is really important to understand how much data we actually collect and process, because we are processing more than 10,000 events per second our players. So we know basically, you know, every if you send your ship somewhere or level up or every basic event, then we know about it and we can somehow process it. So conventional databases or stuff like this wouldn't be sufficient to process these large amounts of data. So we are using, you know, big data technologies. It's now a nice buzzword. So we have our own Hadoop cluster, and we are processing data using Spark, which is a distributed computing framework. And after that, when we crunch all the large amounts of data, then we use basically, it's a personal preference of every analyst. They can use Python, R, Excel, whatever they want.
Okay.
And apart from this, we also use Power BI for our dashboarding and reporting tools, so that we can serve data also to the whole company. So everybody can look about the performance and some basic KPIs or whatever they want.
Okay, I believe that A/B testing method can deliver meaningful results or answers to the questions we ask. So tell us, how exactly does it work?
Yeah, well, basically, you're right. A/B testing is the only way how we can measure the actual impact of one change that you make in the game. So, because you can make some change and then look at the data in some other time and you can see some improvement in whatever KPI you are looking for. But the thing is that apart from this change, there are like millions other factors that could affect the KPI, like the quality of the marketing or whatever, or some holidays in some state that our players are playing in, or basically everything. So A/B testing was designed as a controlled, it's basically a controlled experiment where you divide your players into two equal groups that are basically the same. And then you make the change only for one group and you let them interact with the same game. And in this way you can control, you actually can say that this is the only change between these two groups of players, the only one change that you made, and then you can measure the impact. And you can be sure that there are no other factors, because all like other stuff impacting the players will impact both groups. Mm-hmm. So yeah, this is a methodology that was first introduced in marketing, like in web page optimizations and stuff like this. And basically, you know, we are now using all the good stuff. Recently, we made a change in our A/B testing methodology. We ditched the frequentist approach that is, I believe, mostly used or is the most widespread right now, because it's not really intuitive and it's hard to explain the results to like common people or the stakeholders, you know, producers and game designers, basically people without any statistical background.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that you heard about the confidence intervals or like p-values and stuff
yeah,
like this.
Yeah, it's cool. I heard about it.
it's really confusing and also for people like with background in mathematics, it's mm-hmm. it's often very confusing. Mm-hmm. So we switched to Bayesian methodology, and now it's much more better. You can read about it on our blog. I highly recommend it. Maybe in the future we will have also some of my colleagues talking about this topic mm-hmm. in more depth.
Also, if I may ask, I heard you guys talking about these ABC tests. Can you explain what is it about? That C?
Yeah, basically like A-B testing or A-B test is just the term. And mm-hmm. if you divide players to more categories or more groups, mm-hmm. then you can test like how many different versions of a feature or whatever that you want. But you have to keep in mind that you know, this will shrink the player size or the group size, and then you will need to run the A/B test for a longer time to have some meaningful results. Mm-hmm. So
I sorry to interrupt, but I also heard you guys to refer to that C as a control group or something like that.
Ah,
is
sure.
It?
Sure. Well, basically control group is the group that you are trying to measure the impact of the feature of the change against. So you have some baseline that can be, for example, how the game is performing right now. Mm-hmm. And then you make the change only for a subset of the players. And so the players that don't actually get the change, this is the control group mm-hmm. that you are like controlling the experiment with. And then you have a test group, which is basically the group of players that you change something for.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Also, what are the disadvantages of A/B or ABC testing?
Yeah, well, basically it sounds too good to be, you know, not true, but if it was this easy, we would A/B test basically everything.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
But it's not often possible, because sometimes you need to make some changes in the games that you cannot like roll out only to some subset of players, because they will know about, or they are active on social media and mm-hmm. channels, and they talk about their experience with the games. And if you give something only for the subset of the players, they like the rest of them will be unhappy, and yeah our community management will be unhappy too. Yeah, so this is one thing, that sometimes you just cannot A/B test something. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is that you really need a lot of players to get some meaningful results. So the A/B tests are quite costly. So mm-hmm. the important thing is to test features that you expect to have a large impact on the game, and not just some cosmetic changes, like, I don't know, color of the button or whatever.
Yeah. So to wrap this all up, Peťo, do you remember some recent case study that had an impact on one of our live projects?
Sure. We had a nice case on our game Train Station. I'm sure everybody knows about Train Station.
trains and stuff, you know.
We were working on a new feature called the Special Train Ride. Mm-hmm. And it's basically a mini game for players so they can do something in the meantime when all the trains are dispatched somewhere else. And the hypothesis was that we will like roll out this feature and our new players, when they dispatch the trains, they will have something to, you know, play with. And so it should boost our retention or like prevent the players to forget about the game when they dispatch all the trains. So we made this feature, we ran an A-B test on the new players, we checked the retention, and the results were quite surprising because it in fact lowered the retention of the new players.
So
this was quite surprising, but the hypothesis was that for the new players it was quite confusing because it like it's not what the core game loop is about in, mm-hmm. in Train Station. So the hypothesis is that they got like confused and stopped playing because of this reason. So as a result, we rolled out this feature only for the older players that are always happy with the new content and they already know how to play the game. So it's just a bonus, and it's currently it's not available for the new players. So that's it. Recently, we tested on Train Station our new monetization mechanics. Basically, if you play Train Station, you know that about once a week we have a big offer with like special trains and stuff like this, and this is our best monetization feature. And apart from this, we also introduced a thing called flash offers. Mm-hmm. Which basically lets you buy gems with some discount also throughout the month. And we were afraid that this will negatively impact the bigger offers and mm-hmm. then have a negative impact on the monetization of the game. But this was just a hypothesis. So we decided to A-B test this. And we tested two cases where we didn't offer the flash offers to one group of players for all 3 days before the bigger offer, and the next group only one day before the offer. And we were measuring whether it has or doesn't have some negative impact on the bigger monetization mechanic. And it turned out that it is completely okay to let the smaller offers run, you know, for longer. Okay. And so we stayed with that.
That's interesting. So thank you, Peťo, for explaining us how the game analytics department in Pixel Federation works.
No problem.
And thank you guys for watching. See you in the next video. Bye.
Bye. There will be more videos about data and analytics in the future. So if you are interested in this topic, don't forget to subscribe. Right here.